हेलो दोस्तों, वेलकम टू पायोज एकेडमी। आज के इस वीडियो में हम एक मॉक इंटरव्यू देखने वाले हैं, तो चलो हम इस वीडियो को स्टार्ट करते हैं।
पायोज लर्न द स्मार्टर वे। गुड मॉर्निंग, लेट्स स्टार्ट विद अ ब्रीफ इंट्रोडक्शन। कैन यू टेल मी अबाउट योर करंट वर्किंग प्रोफाइल?
गुड मॉर्निंग, करंटली आई एम वर्किंग एज अ प्रोसेस डिजाइन इंजीनियर। माई रोल मेनली फोकसेस ऑन preparing and reviewing process engineering deliverables such as process flow diagrams, that is PFDs, piping and instrumentation diagrams, that is P&IDs, equipment data sheets and line sizing calculations. I am also involved in pump and heat exchanger sizing, preparation of hydraulic calculations and pressure drop estimations. In addition, I coordinate closely with other disciplines like piping, instrumentation and mechanical to ensure proper integration of design. I also provide technical support during commissioning, troubleshooting and process optimization activities. That's all about my current role.
That sounds good. Can you tell me about the various projects you have worked on?
I have worked on both greenfield and brownfield projects. For example, I was part of greenfield project for a specialty chemical plant, where I was responsible for developing the complete process design package, including heat and material balances, equipment sizing and P&IDs. I also worked on revamp projects where the challenge was to optimize existing systems, such as improving piping networks and heat exchanger performance to meet new capacity requirements. In one utility optimization project, I was involved in upgrading a cooling water system, which included redesigning the cooling tower and associated distribution system. These projects have given me experience in both detail engineering and practical implementation.
Could you explain a detailed P&ID of pumps delivering liquid from one vessel to another?
In such a P&ID, the system typically starts with the source vessel, which has a nozzle at the bottom for liquid withdrawal. A suction line connects the vessel to the pump, and this line usually includes an isolation wall, a strainer and sometimes a spectacle blind for maintenance. The centrifugal pump is then shown, and on the discharge side we have a non-return wall to avoid backflow, followed by an isolation wall. The discharge line connects to the destination vessel. Pressure gauges are placed at both suction and discharge sides of the pump, and flow elements may be installed in the discharge line. Both the source and destination vessels are shown with level transmitters and safety walls. Drains and vents are also included for proper operation and maintenance.
Can you explain the steps for pump sizing calculations?
Pump sizing starts with defining the process requirement. First, we calculate the required flow rate based on process demand. Next, we calculate total head requirement, which is the sum of static head, pressure head and frictional losses in the suction and discharge lines. Static head is the elevation difference between suction liquid level and discharge point. Frictional losses are calculated using Darcy-Weisbach equation or standard friction charts. Once we determine the total dynamic head, we select a pump curve that can deliver the required flow rate at this head. Finally, we check the net positive suction head available, that is NPSHA, against NPSH required, that is NPSHR, to ensure pump will not cavitate under operating conditions.
Draw and explain a pump curve.
A pump curve is a graphical representation of pump performance. The x-axis represents flow rate, while the y-axis represents head developed by pump. The main curve, that is flow versus head curve, shows that as flow increases, the developed head decreases. The efficiency curve is also plotted, showing the best efficiency point where the pump should ideally operate. Power consumption and NPSHR curves are also included. By analyzing the pump curve, we can select the operating point that matches system resistance curve, ensuring efficient and reliable operation.
What is shutoff pressure and where is it applied?
Shutoff pressure is the maximum pressure a pump can generate when the discharge wall is completely closed and there is no flow. It is the important parameter because the pump casing, piping and connected equipment must be designed to withstand the maximum pressure. During design, we always consider shutoff pressure to ensure safety. It is also used during testing of pumps to confirm performance.
Can you give me the pressure drop formula for line sizing?
The pressure drop is calculated using Darcy-Weisbach equation, which is delta P is equal to F into L by D into rho V square by 2. Here, F is Darcy friction factor, L is pipe length, D is pipe diameter, rho is fluid density, and V is velocity of fluid. This equation is widely used for accurate pressure drop estimation in liquid and gas lines.
In this formula, is the friction factor fanning or Darcy?
The equation I mentioned uses Darcy friction factor. It is important to note that the fanning friction factor is 1/4 of the Darcy factor. Many references and correlations uses Darcy, but we must always check which convention is being followed to avoid mistakes.
Tell me the steps for heat exchanger sizing using Kern's method.
Kern's method is widely used shortcut method for shell and tube heat exchanger design. The steps are, first one is estimate the heat duty based on process requirements using mass flow rate and enthalpy change. After that, estimate the log mean temperature difference, that is LMTD, for chosen flow arrangement. After that, assume an overall heat transfer coefficient based on the type of fluids. Then calculate the required heat transfer area. After that, select tentative tube size, layout and number of passes. Then estimate pressure drops on shell and tube sides and check if they are acceptable. After that, revise tube layout or passes if required to meet both thermal and hydraulic requirements.
Let's take a practical example. How would you size a heat exchanger for heating water by steam?
First, I would define the inlet and outlet conditions for water. Suppose water is to be heated from 30 degrees Celsius to 80 degrees Celsius at a given flow rate. The heat duty is calculated as mass flow multiplied by specific heat and temperature rise. Next, I would calculate the steam consumption using its latent heat. Since steam condenses at a constant temperature, the temperature difference between steam and water is used to calculate the LMTD. Then, by assuming an heat transfer coefficient, I calculate the required area. After that, I would select tube size and layout, then check pressure drops. This approach ensures both thermal and mechanical feasibility.
Explain LMTD for concurrent, countercurrent and cross flow.
Log mean temperature difference, that is LMTD. It represents an effective temperature driving force in a heat exchanger. For co-current flow, where both fluids move in same direction, the LMTD is lowest because temperature difference decreases rapidly along the length. For countercurrent flow, where fluids move in opposite direction, LMTD is highest, making it the most efficient arrangement. For cross flow, where one fluid flows perpendicular to the other, the LMTD is intermediate, depending on whether the flow is mixed or unmixed.
From where do we get LMTD correction factors?
LMTD correction factors are obtained from standard charts and correlations given in design literature, such as Kern's method and TEMA standards. The correction factor accounts for multi-pass shell and tube arrangements where true temperature profiles deviate from simple countercurrent flow.
How do we assume the value of heat transfer coefficient U?
The value of U is usually assumed based on experience and published data for similar services. For example, condensing steam on one side gives high U values while gas-to-gas exchangers have very low U values. Once we assume a reasonable value, we perform area calculation. Later, this is refined by detailed calculation considering film coefficient, fouling factors and material resistance.
What tube sizes are normally used in industry?
The most common tube sizes are 3x4 inch and 1 inch OD. The length of tubes typically ranges from 2 meters to 6 meters depending on its duty. Tube wall thickness varies according to design pressure and corrosion allowance. Smaller diameters may be used for compact exchangers, but 3x4 inch and 1 inch are industry standards.
Can you explain the working principle of a cooling tower?
A cooling tower works on the principle of evaporative cooling. Warm water from process is distributed at the top of cooling tower and allowed to trickle down through fill media, which increases surface area. Air is drawn upward either naturally or by fans. A small portion of water evaporates and this evaporation removes heat from remaining water. The cooled water is collected in a basin at bottom and pumped back to the process. Cooling towers are widely used in power plants, refineries and chemical plants.
What are dry bulb and wet bulb temperatures?
Dry bulb temperature is the ordinary air temperature measured by a thermometer exposed to air. Wet bulb temperature is measured by wrapping the bulb of a thermometer with a wet wick and exposed it to airflow. The wet bulb temperature is always lower than dry bulb temperature unless air is fully saturated. The difference between dry bulb and wet bulb temperature is an indication of humidity in the air. And this concept is very important in cooling tower operation.
Lastly, what are the various utilities used in industry?
Common utilities include steam for heating, cooling water and chilled water for cooling, compressed air for instrumentation and operations, nitrogen for inerting and blanketing, electricity for motors and drivers, and fuel gases for furnace and boilers. These utilities form the backbone of process industries, supporting smooth and safe operation of plants.
Thank you. That's all from my side.
Thank you.
Bios. Learn the smarter way.